Macmillan Audio presents Opening My Eyes Underwater, Essays on Hope, Humanity, and Our Hero, Michelle Obama. Written and read for you by Ashley Woodfolk. For Mommy, the First Lady of My Heart. Step out of your comfort zones and soar. Michelle Obama, Howard University Speech, 2016. Foreword. Everyone has been asked the question in 100 different iterations by the time they reach high school. It had happened to me so often, in fact, that after having to write what felt like a million essays about it as a kid, I hadn't sat down and thought about it in years. Who is your biggest role model? A worksheet from fifth grade probably read. Who do you aspire to be like? My eighth grade English teacher may have scrawled across the whiteboard. If you could have dinner with anyone, alive or dead, who would it be and why? A college admissions essay for my safety school begged to know. But once I did think about it again, once I focused my energy the way I used to when I was asked about what I considered to be arbitrary nonsense by adults who just wanted to keep me busy, I realized why the question was so salient and why it had been asked again and again. I could finally see why it was important for young me to take a second and consider who I might want to model my life after. The reason role models are important and the truth your teachers don't want to tell you are one and the same. No one knows what the hell they're doing. Not any of the adults in your life, not your seemingly perfect older siblings or the most put-together juniors and seniors, not even your heroes. Take comfort in the fact that we're all just making it up as we go along, making the best choices we can with the information we have at the time. We're making it work. But what those people do have is a few more years of experience. They've made mistakes they'd rather not see you repeat. So emulating someone whose life looks like what you hope yours one day will is sometimes incredibly helpful. I think about all those essay questions a little differently now. Instead of assuming adults were giving me a pointless assignment to keep me busy, I think that maybe they were trying to guide me. Maybe they were attempting to help me find the keys to the car of my life and give me a little direction. If I had the chance to rewrite any of those essays now, I'd pick a human most people would think was totally cliche. I'd pick someone whom I could write a whole book about. I'd pick someone like Michelle Obama. Something tells me that choice would be a good one, if only because the internet is littered with roundups of Michelle Obama's quotations. There are lists pulled from her autobiography, Becoming, lists that are a compilation of wise words from her speeches, and even sound bites from some of her most viral interviews. But regardless of when or how these words entered our collective consciousness, one thing has always been true. We collect Michelle Obama's words because even though she too has had moments where she didn't know what the hell she was doing, her life has had an incredible trajectory. Despite the confusion and cluelessness inherent in being human, Michelle is a maverick. She has lived an utterly remarkable life, full of as much unexpected opportunity as confidently executed choices, with as many exhilarating twists and turns as massive, independently built successes. Many, including me, feel that she is extraordinary, and not just because she happened to marry the man who would go on to become America's first Black president. Though perhaps something can be said for the fact that she saw something exceptional in him, that the same magnetism that could attract and sustain the attention and love of a bright, ambitious, and nearly unstoppable young woman may have been part of the reason he landed in the White House. Michelle Obama is a brilliant thinker and creative in her own right, and I've sought out her words when I was looking for encouragement or a confidence boost before making an intimidating decision in my own life, So much so that an inner refrain became, "What would Michelle do?" Or sometimes, "What would she say?" Just as I did when I was younger, I still sometimes find myself feeling lost or overwhelmed or unsure if I'm doing the right thing. And because I didn't know Michelle Obama existed until I had graduated from college, I didn't have her words to call upon, and I didn't have her as a go-to answer for all those essay questions as early as I wish I had. This book is a reimagining of that, of how I might have applied Michelle's wisdom to my life had I encountered it sooner. It's a love letter to a strong, sensitive, incredibly humble, but still heroic Black woman whom generations of women now have the privilege to admire. And it's a meditation on what I and so many others have in common with one of the most aspirational and inspirational role models of our time. I'm sure Michelle would say anyone could accomplish the things she has with the right set of circumstances, opportunities, and preparation. But I know how hard something like that can be to believe. My hope is that with this book, you'll see that achieving a life you're proud of, a life that others might even one day aspire to emulate, isn't as impossible as it might seem. My hope is that through listening, you'll see just how capable you are, how powerful you can be, and how much you have in common with the indomitable Michelle Obama, and maybe with me too. Every role model was a kid once. Every role model has regrets. Every role model is as human as you and I, even Michelle Obama. And still, they blossomed. You will too. Failure is an important part of your growth and development of resilience. Don't be afraid to fail. Michelle Obama, speech at Apollo Theater, 2015. I don't fail. Or maybe I should say that I've never been okay with failing. I'm a semi-reformed perfectionist, one who was once so hell-bent on being perfect that I preferred to give up on things than to try my best and potentially fail at them. I quit swim lessons when I was 6. One Saturday morning during free swim at the end of class, the teacher explained that we would have to go underwater and open our eyes without goggles at the next lesson to recover something from below the surface. I went home and told my mother I wasn't doing that. The chlorine would sting. And why would I put myself through unnecessary pain when Olympic swimmers could wear goggles and I never went to the pool or beach without mine? I couldn't think of a reason or a situation in which the skill would be one I'd need. And deep down, I doubted my ability to keep my unprotected eyes open long enough underwater to retrieve the rings my teacher would drop into the pool for us to find. My mother asked the teacher if I could still wear my goggles, but she said no. So I refused to go back. I quit ballet when I was 8 and a half because a ballerina came to my class and showed us what her feet looked like. She explained that when you get pointe shoes, you lose toenails and develop corns and bunions, and that even breaking a toe or two is normal. I was afraid I wouldn't be able to deal with the pain, that the second I tried to go on point and it hurt too badly, or the dancers around me succeeded before I could, I would feel like an untalented loser. I loved dancing, I thought, so I should quit before pointe shoes were handed out and broken in. I should go before everyone could be better than I'd ever be. I went on to quit the saxophone and the clarinet, chorus, basketball, and competitive cheerleading, though I stuck that out the longest, despite feeling like I wasn't as good or as flexible as the other girls. I even wanted to quit when I was learning to drive because I couldn't figure out how to parallel park. And on it went. At the same time, I stuck with the things I did well, the things I knew I had to do to keep up my veneer of perfection. I got excellent grades. I was an officer in student government. I was on the yearbook and prom committees, and I was in poetry club. I had the list of colleges I wanted to apply to finalized by sophomore year. I aced tests and signed up for AP classes, worked, and went to church every Sunday with my family. And was a good girl. always making it home before curfew. I met everyone's expectations, almost always. As I read Michelle Obama's memoir, I deeply related to her description of herself as a box checker. She writes that she got good grades and applied to the best schools and remained laser-focused on her goals. She wasn't, as she called it, a swerver. And despite my streak of quitting, I was the same way. Some might have seen me as a quitter, but I saw myself as someone unwilling to take unnecessary risks. Why risk failing when I knew I could excel at so many other, more important things? But I wasn't exactly happy. I was always anxious and overwhelmed, and working so hard to be seen as perfect when I was so far from that ideal was exhausting. Similarly, Michelle had painted herself into a corner. She'd become the person she thought she was supposed to be, the person she thought everyone else expected her to be. And it wasn't until she experienced major loss, the death of a close friend and her father, that she realized where all that box checking had landed her. She was successful, but at what cost? When Michelle met Barack, she was at this crossroads. And meeting someone whose life had followed such an untraditional path inspired her to ask herself a new question. Instead of thinking about who everyone else expected her to be, Michelle was able to ask herself, who do I want to be? She went on to take some big risks, including a huge career change for herself, and of course eventually agreeing to support her husband's decision to pursue politics. And in a swerve to end all swerves, his running for president of the United States, Michelle encountered the largest risk she'd ever taken. She was risking her very lucrative career, her children's futures, and the life she'd imagined for herself all at once. My crossroads came when I decided to listen to a whisper that had always been inside me, but that I'd buried again and again because the risk of failing was too great. I wanted to be a writer. This would be my big swerve, the first and perhaps only big risk I'd ever been brave enough to take, and I would, and did, fail. A lot. Take, for instance, this very book. This is not the book I set out to write. If you scroll back through miles of my Twitter feed, you'll see just how true that is. A very different book was announced ages ago, one that was intended to be a biography of the Obamas, both Michelle and Barack, and one I tried and failed to complete for nearly 2 years, spanning the pregnancy and birth of my first kid, my departure from a professional career in publishing, the COVID-19 pandemic, unprecedented civil and racial unrest, and the worst mental health months I'd had in my whole life. During this time, and with the help of therapy, I realized my fear of failure came from a fear of vulnerability. I had never written a book like the one I was attempting, and trying to do things I've never done before always puts me in a very vulnerable position, a place where someone could say, "You suck," and it might be true. It was the same way I'd felt as a kid when I'd been so afraid of failing, of opening my eyes underwater, going on point, playing a new instrument or sport, that I'd quit. Feeling incompetent or inadequate is a very dangerous way to feel if you're someone, like I was, who ties their self-worth directly to how good or bad they are at everything. I feared if people found out I wasn't perfect, they'd figure out I wasn't valuable. And if I wasn't valuable, was I worthy of their time, or more importantly, their love? The secret was, everyone already knew I wasn't perfect. The secret was, I was loved and accepted anyway. But back to the book. I wanted to quit, but I didn't. And because that book just would not and could not work, not for me, not at the time, not in the world as it existed, I had to admit it. I had tried, and I had failed. When my editors and I realized the book wasn't working, we had a few conversations about why, and then decided to pivot. to move in a new and different direction. As I'd been researching the original book, I'd collected a ton of quotes by both Michelle and Barack, and I kept being drawn to Michelle's, especially any that were about success and self-love and resilience. The quote that opens this essay about failure and growth was one that had always stuck with me. I couldn't shake the assertion that I would only grow and get better every time I failed at something. It was revolutionary, this idea that I was inherently valuable, even when I wasn't perfect, that perhaps imperfection was a good thing. It would help me grow. If you're anything like me, anything like Michelle, or even the exact opposite of a box checker, I want to make sure you hear this, so I'll say it again. You are inherently valuable, even when you are not perfect. So this book will not be perfect, because despite my tireless efforts to overcome my own humanity, I am not perfect. But I will be honest, and I will be open. And I hope you find some courage in these essays all the same. I hope you'll be as touched and inspired by Michelle Obama's words as I have been. I'm no longer quitting when I'm afraid I will fail. I'm jumping into the pool with both eyes open, lacing up those point shoes, sitting down at my computer with my heart in my hands. I'm listening to Michelle, and I'm being brave with the hope that I'll come out the other side more resilient for it. This may be a fiasco, but this is, as Mary Oliver wrote, my one wild and precious life. I'm done with checking boxes. I'm taking so many beautiful, terrifying risks. I am still afraid, but I'm doing it all anyway. Your story is what you have, what you'll always have. It is something to own. Michelle Obama, Becoming. My story starts the way most stories do, with me not knowing what the hell I was doing, but thinking that I knew everything. Of course, I was born at a certain time, in a certain place, and into a certain family. And of course, all those things had profound effects on the way I live and move through the world. But whenever anyone asks to hear my story, I rarely start before the year I was 12. 12 is an interesting age. Even as an adult, I'd assert that being 12 was the worst year of my life, and I doubt that I'm alone. Partially because, as I mentioned, I didn't know what I was doing while assuming I knew everything, but also because it was the first time I felt like I was my own person, that I didn't have the complete protection of my parents, that I was a bit on my own. But also, being 12 is just really, really hard. The year I turned 12 was the year I got my period, the year I had my first intensely painful crush, the year I got braces, and the year I got boobs. As if all of that wasn't enough to chip away at my little preteen soul, it was also the year I was targeted by a bully for the first time in my life. Bullying is fascinating, because it is essentially someone else deciding to tell the world who they think you are. It is someone deciding that, for whatever reason, you don't have a say in your own story, and instead, they attempt to narrate, dictate, and change your story themselves. Bullies take power away from their victims by editing the narrative of someone else's existence to whatever they want it to be. You're weak. You're dumb. You're ugly. You're worthless. And it's painful because they're always wrong. The story they're telling either misrepresents their victim completely or only tells a fraction of the truth, which they twist and skew to cause the maximum amount of pain. Keep this in mind. We'll come back to it later. Before the seventh grade, I'd experienced some light bullying. I had been called a few names in elementary school because I was so skinny and awkward, because I spoke, as some put it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.